pasta. So I'm from Vancouver, and we're known for about three things besides the rain. Number one, we're known for our scenery. I live on a ski mountain next to the Pacific Ocean. Number two, we're known for our hospitality. This conference is being held by Clio, a Vancouver business. And number three, we're known for our food. You may not know this, but Vancouver was recently voted one of the top food cities in the world. Recently, I got to try a new Italian restaurant, and it was hands down the best food I've ever tried. And it was also the best customer service. So I was debating between the tomato sauce and the truffle sauce. I'm not a big mushroom fan, however I am now. And me being the social media nerd that I am, as soon as I was done, pulled out my phone, took a picture, because I'm that person, and I knew they had social media because I looked on their menu and they had a Twitter account, Facebook page, everything. So I started looking for them and I couldn't find them, which was really odd because I knew they had social media. And I found tons of other pictures, people talking about them and posting, you know, really good sort of status updates. And what I found was that this restaurant was actually owned by a larger company that managed a whole bunch of different restaurants. And they made the mistake of having one corporate account for everything. So they made it nearly impossible for me to share my good experience with up to 18,000 Twitter followers, which is a really big loss for them. So how is this relevant for you, the lawyer? This is relevant because your clients want to share their good experience with you online via Google review, you know, Facebook review, etc. They really want to share it, and I've seen it time and time again, which is once these reviews are up, it's really good for search engine optimization as well. And a recent study by Westlaw confirms that 54% of consumers will actually hire a lawyer based on their social media presence, their good social media presence, and 30% already have. And I think these numbers are going to go up as well. Now, a little bit about me, if you don't know me yet, is I worked as a legal assistant for a few years, and I also worked in business development for about several years in an IP firm. And the way I got inspired to use this is pretty awesome, is I actually heard a webinar by Kevin O'Keefe from LexBlog. He was my big inspiration, and something he said really resonated with me. And he said that lawyers should strive to become the CNN of their practice area. And I heard this in 2010, which is amazing, it really stuck with me. And the way you do this is by sharing relevant content. So you share, you know, how you solve the client's problem. You obviously don't say the client or the name. And you can also share how-to posts, etc. And the way one of my clients did this is I have a personal injury client from Vancouver. Now, if you're from Vancouver, you might remember that we had a huge blackout about maybe a year ago, 2 years ago. It lasted 3 days, and by the third day, people were like zombie apocalypse driving. It was crazy. And what they did, or what we did, was we actually wrote a blog post about what to do in a blackout. You know, how do you, like what you should have before, like an emergency kit, how to stop at a four-way stop sign, because people actually forgot how to do that. And, you know, they actually got a number of files through that post. You know, people that had car accidents, etc., they actually got almost all those files. So your clients really do want to share their positive experiences with you. So let me change this. So one main concern I hear about, and I'm going to go through four, is, are people really using social media to find lawyers? And I've gone through, yes, they are. So I'm part of a North Vancouver mothers group, and we discuss everything. So we discuss, like, food, discipline, marriage, or lack thereof. And recently, someone asked this question: does anyone have a recommendation for an IP lawyer? And of course, I recommended the firm I used to work for, called the managing partner and said, someone's using social media to ask for this, which is great because I got this screenshot. And I'm not sure if they retained this law firm or not yet, but I do know that this recommendation was seen by 3,000 people. So there's 3,000 people in this group, and I know that, you know, it's not necessarily seen by everyone in the group, but there's probably quite a few people that saw it. And people are going to keep recommending this. And if anyone does need an IP lawyer in the future, I know they're going to come to this or they're going to ask me again what the name was. And it's happened numerous times. Another example was I was getting my hair done right before this conference. And I was looking through my phone and someone asked for a corporate lawyer. There was 8 responses. And the difference now is that I actually could put in the Facebook page of the firm I recommended in the comment. And I was the only one to put the Facebook page. And this person contacted the lawyer that I referred. So it's not just enough to use social media now. You actually need to go and have a Facebook page, have a Twitter account. I recommend that at least you use Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn. You should have a LinkedIn company page. A lot of firms don't know to do that. And on my blog, I have a few posts about how to do that. It's socialmediaforlawfirms.com, and you can go there for a few things. I'm not going to go through how to actually create the accounts, because there's Google for that. And what's really important with this is that you cannot buy this kind of advertising. You know, there's no way to buy a recommendation from a trusted friend. And in this group, we all trust each other. Like, if someone moves from North Vancouver to Kelowna, people cry if someone leaves. So it's pretty interesting. So the next concern I hear about a lot is compliance. You know, this is a very big deal. And again, I'm going to reference Kevin. His social media policy is simple. 3 words. Don't be stupid. You know, and that's... it's. I really use that actually quite a lot because compliance just ends up being a big issue. And another thing you can do is create a social media policy. If you don't already have one, you can just Google it and you're going to find, you know, a lot of them. And some common compliance issues are confidentiality, IP, account ownership, inappropriate activity, lack of awareness. If you don't have social media accounts already, I suggest that you put them in your name. So you don't put the firm name, you don't use a logo as your picture, because people don't want to talk to logos. They want to talk to you because they trust you. They want to talk to a person, not a logo. And if you do decide to change firms, you can actually take your accounts with you. You know, and a friend of mine named Noah Kravitz, he worked for a company called Phone Dog. Now, when he left, he asked if he could take his Twitter account with him. They said yes. And later on, they came back to him and they asked for it. He said no. They sued him, saying that his Twitter followers were the equivalent of a client list, which is crazy, because on Twitter, your followers can be robots. So they're not exactly going to be your clients. Now, they settled out of court. So I don't know exactly what happened, but thankfully things like this don't happen very much anymore. The West Virginia Bar actually stated their opinion on the matter, and actually most bars have. And what they said is that lawyers need to be mindful of their online communications. They need to avoid disorderly contact, and they need to beware of inadvertently creating client-attorney relationships. I suggest that you look up your state bar, or you look up your provincial law society if you're in Canada. And the opinion also stated that lawyers are free to connect with clients and former clients. They're free to accept client reviews, which is great. They can comment on reviews and endorse other lawyers. The next and last concern I hear about quite often is time. So social media, learning how to use it is actually front-loaded. You know, it's going to take a lot of time to, not a lot of time, it's going to take more time in the beginning to actually learn the ins and outs of each platform. You're going to have to learn, you know, on Twitter what's an acceptable status update, on Facebook. Each one is sort of worded differently, or how many words you can use as well. And some are more picture-based, such as, you know, Instagram. You have to post pictures on there. And there's a lot of tools that you can use as well to save time. So you can use tools like TweetDeck, Hootsuite. They're free to use unless you want paid sort of versions of it. And they allow you to plan tweets, to plan posts. I suggest that you don't use it and just forget about it. You know, you can schedule some posts or blog posts, but you need to be on there. You need to actually respond to people, because that's how you build relationships with people, is you actually talk to them. Like, you're actually interested in them, because I see this mistake quite often. And again, it's about personal relationships. It's about networking. So you think about the way you're networking here. You know, you're actually interacting with people and you're using the app, which I really suggest that you use it, because it's actually awesome. I love it. And you think about the way people are interacting on this app, is they're actually talking to people. I mean, they're sharing pictures of their nail polish on their toes, right? Like, they're really connecting with people. And, you know, that's what it is. It's the personal connection. And another thing you can do, which a lawyer I know, which is, he's phenomenal online, his name is Mitch Jackson, and he stands behind a cause. So what he talks about a lot is distracted driving. And people know him from, he uses the hashtag, like, stop distracted driving. And he really loves what he does. He's not corny at all. Like, he actually enjoys this. And as a side note, if someone gets into an accident, if someone is, you know, a victim of distracted driving, they go to him. So he's ended up getting seven-figure clients, actually, through settling cases. And I mean, that's really awesome. So if you can find a cause, or if you have a cause that you already believe in, you know, talk about it on social media. And lastly, I'm going to go through the title of this talk. It was how I helped my client get, you know, a multi-million dollar file through Facebook here. And it's actually quite simple. Is my client is a Texas personal injury law firm, and they specialize, you know, in offshore accidents, bus accidents, all those sorts of things. And part of my job is scanning the news. So I scan the news for interesting articles they can share and potential clients. And tragically, there was a chemical explosion one day, and they specialize in this. And, you know, I brought the news article to the managing partner's, you know, attention. And with lawyers, you don't want to be seen as ambulance chasers. And unfortunately, that's something that happens actually quite regularly. And the way that we went around this, or the way that we actually worked with this, was we created a status update that was informational only. There was no link on the bottom. There was no call to action. It was about what to do after a chemical explosion. Not to sign anything after a chemical explosion. Not to... you know, it's a very emotional time. You know, there was injuries from this, there was deaths from this. And one of the lawyers that I worked with there, he actually went through a chemical explosion himself. His father actually died in a chemical explosion, so he knew what to do. Like, he knew that insurance companies were, you know, going to hound these people. And they ended up representing almost every victim of this explosion, and they settled all these cases. And what we did with this status update is we used Facebook advertising. Now, this was a few years ago, and with Facebook, you're actually able to target your ads or your posts. And this city was 5,000 people. So we targeted the city, and we targeted 50 miles surrounding the city. You know, so almost every single person actually saw this post. And it was pretty amazing that we actually didn't have one negative comment. You know, there wasn't anyone that said that they were ambulance chasers, which was one of my main concerns, so it was good. And we actually used this status update as a template within this firm, which is amazing. And that's how I got my client, or how we as a team got the client and settled a multi-million dollar file. And that's it. So I know that my presentation's actually running pretty short. We have about 14 minutes left, and I know you guys probably want to go for lunch and everything. But if you guys have any questions, you can ask them now. I'm not sure if anyone does. Yes. 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 So part of my job, or what I do, is I do social media marketing. I've done it for about 6 years now. I'm lucky that I get to do something I absolutely love. It's kind of funny how much I love legal marketing. I've always worked in sales, so I worked in, you know, jewelry. I sold tons of, I was a travel agent as well. So I got to combine like my passion for social media and my like love for legal marketing. And working, I worked in an IP firm for several years, and something that's kind of interesting with that is I worked with one of the managing partners, and we traveled across the world. Like, we went and saw like the heads of multinational corporations, the presidents of countries. I got to meet the president of Chile, and it was funny when I brought up social media to her, she was actually worried. She's like, I don't want to look stupid, you know, and that was a really common concern, and we worked together, and now she's known as like one of the pioneers of social media. So a lot of times, there's a moment lawyers get it. You know, like there's a moment that like it sort of doesn't make sense, but once you go through these stories, it's just logical. You know, like social media is very similar just to traditional marketing, just done online. You know, so it's like, to me, it just makes sense. And not everybody's going to get, like, a $1 million file exactly the way I did. So you kind of have to have, like, creative thinking. But, yeah, that's it. So I do partner with like, and almost every type of law firm as well. It's not just personal injury. It's sort of everything. Maybe you first?
Have you or have any of your clients looked into the ethics of Facebook advertising, not on a geographic basis, but on other demographics? I've had some conversation with Legal Ethics Council of Missouri, and they expressed some concern that if it's not geographic,
yes,
perhaps it's a problem.
Yes, I've seen, you know, in the past, maybe like 4 or 5 years ago, there was tons of different concerns, you know, about social media. And I haven't seen an actual concern that addressed that, per se. Again, I'm not a lawyer, so I can't give the exact ethical, you know, opinions about that. However, I keep going back to, you know, the different law societies and bars, and they really go through all the rules of advertising, and I really think if you just look to those rules and apply them, you'll see that it is just traditional marketing done online. And you do have to use the same rules that you use for advertising. You know, so however you advertise in other places, you just go through that. And I may not have answered your question fully, but I can look into it and come back.
Well, most states that don't have rules that are up to date with...
Nothing's caught up yet.
I mean, in Missouri, it still says that if you're advertising through a letter...
Yes. Really?
What?
Yeah. It's a fine that, like, and I don't know if you guys are going to see Gary talk after this, but I hope you do because he's just marvelous. And I heard him talk about compliance, and he was like, just don't make that a reason why you don't do it. I mean, it's in this day and age, in 2016, I don't see a lot of lawyers worrying about it. But I get it. And as lawyers, you should be, you know, concerned with compliance. Again, those issues that I went through with IP, copyright, I mean, don't use pictures from Google. You know, like, go through and actually, like, get stock photos or use your own photos. I mean, I use my own photos most of the time. And if you follow me, I just share pictures of, like, the ocean, of, like, my kids. I post about them all the time. And it's incredible. You connect with people based on that, but I won't go off on a tangent there. But again, yeah, with the Facebook advertising, I haven't had an issue with it. But I would say, like, just go to the bars. I mean, even the bars don't have opinions yet. It would be interesting to see. I don't know if anyone knows if anyone has, like, specific Facebook advertising rules in the bars, but I actually haven't seen them yet at all. I was researching a lot of compliance things before this talk because, like I said, I know it's a big issue. And there are a lot of case studies. I know if you just Google, like, social media compliance, I think Nikki Black wrote a whole bunch of things, and she referenced a whole bunch of cases. So I suggest you look there as well. No problem. You?
How do you give advice to maybe law students transitioning into the profession and how they deal with their past and future?
Oh, that's a big one. I'm actually really glad that they didn't do that when I was younger. Is that the question is for law students, how do they maybe transition their social media from personal to business and you know, worry about past things as well? And I find that now people are a lot more forgiving of your past or, you know, like, not professional posts, because everyone knows that you do use social media and kind of move into it. And for example, like Facebook, if you're going to use Facebook to market your practice, I really suggest that you create the page, like a business page, so that you're keeping your personal profile private. I still believe in using your personal profile because you connect with a lot of people in different ways. For example, like, my husband passed away 8 years ago, and I connect with a lot of people that have dealt with it before. Now, I probably couldn't have shared that on my business page, but via the personal page, a lot of people kind of connect with that. So for law students, I really wish that they taught social media in law school more. And it's funny, a lot of younger lawyers are actually more hesitant to use social media for that exact reason. But I just find that it shouldn't be a reason to stop them, just to sort of, you know, look up other lawyers that are doing what they do, look up their competitors, you know, and see what they're doing online too, and kind of use them as a guideline for it.
Question, when you did your successful Facebook campaign, did you launch it off the firm's existing Facebook account, or did you create one dedicated to that?
Yeah, so the question was, for my client that got the $1 million file, or just for ads in general, did the firm use a separate Facebook page for that particular accident? And this firm does. Actually, before I came in to work in social media for them, they have an offshore page as well as a regular page. Now, this was a chemical explosion, so no, they did just use this from that actual firm page. But I'm not exactly sure if people should create separate pages. I find that it can be confusing for some people. Like, they might look up the firm and then see they have another page. But from an SEO standpoint, it might be a good idea as well. I know you work in SEO, so do you have an opinion if it's better?
No, this is perception.
Yes.
From an SEO point of view, it's almost...
It's just the same.
You just worry about the traffic coming.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. So I find that, I mean, if you care about your clients, which I think everyone does, to use other social media accounts and a blog as well to kind of back it up, and you know, create a blog. My client didn't do this, but on Facebook, what they could have done is written a blog post about what to do during a chemical explosion and then posted the blog post on their page. And it would just be sort of, people could click back to it and that would build like their expert reputation. So for Facebook, I really do think it's better to have one account. I can see how if you had lots of different practice areas, maybe have different, but I think having one account, having different social media accounts, and just to speak authentically and not salesy, which I think most firms, they don't do now, and that's sort of what I think for it. Are there any other questions? Yes. Okay. Yeah. So the question was, what kind of tips can you, or what are my tips about how to grow your following? The way I grew my following was I followed other people in my industry. So I followed Kevin O'Keefe, and there's a lot of other people actually I got to meet, or I'm going to meet for the first time today. Follow other lawyers in your industry. Usually they'll want to follow you back as well. Look up your competitors, see who they're following. And again, don't focus so much on the number of followers you have. Focus on the quality of followers you have. A lot of social media people that give me a bad name will just be like, I'm going to get you like 10,000 followers and I'm going to do this. And I mean, it does give you some credibility, but I find now it's not as big of a deal. And on Facebook, there's tools you can use. You can actually upload your contacts file. So you can go into Outlook or you can go into Gmail, and you can actually upload all of your contacts. It won't automatically add people. It will send the Facebook, like the person, like a recommendation. I'm not sure if you guys see it, but it'll say like suggested page. And some of my clients do that as well. And I think you can download your LinkedIn contacts in a file and actually upload that into Facebook as well. And I have that on my blog as well. If you just search, you know, how to download your file, your contacts file into Facebook, that's a really good way too. Hopefully that answers your question. Okay. Are there any more? Yes.
Is there anything lawyers can do or should do online?
Yeah. There's a lot of things. I mean, we were talking about some people as well. And I think it's, you know, don't badmouth people. You know, like, have an opinion. There's a lot of things, instead of you shouldn't do, there's a lot of things you should do. And I find that some lawyers have been scared of sharing an opinion because they don't want to, like, polarize another group of people. Like, they're worried that if they share this, some people won't like them. But I find that if you share your opinion, people will respect you a lot more. And to be yourself. Like, don't worry about other people not perceiving you as professional. Because if you're just vanilla, you're just like every other lawyer online, people won't really be interested. It's sort of like here. Like, you want to talk to people that are actually interesting to you. So I find that that's sort of the best thing to do. And to not do... I mean, it's not really pertaining to being successful or not. It's just like not sharing client information and sort of that sort of thing. I mean, I probably wouldn't share all my political opinions, but some people do. I do know a lot of lawyers that do. In Canada, we've got like 7 or 8 political parties, so it doesn't really matter as much. But yeah, that would be my opinion. Any other questions at all? And sorry, I didn't repeat the question on that. It was just if there's anything that lawyers shouldn't do online. Yes, sorry.
I got 2 questions.
Yep.
First is, to what extent how do reviews show up on Facebook?
Yep.
And how are they being visible?
Yep.
Are they being visible to all of my followers, or are they visible to just the person who posted it and their friends? So that's my first question.
Yep. That's a very good question. So the first question was, on Facebook, who can see your reviews? And on Facebook, everybody can see the reviews on there. It's hard to see. you actually have to go to like more, like there's about four or five different tabs. It's photos, posts, events, and some people will show the reviews right on the top. And you go through there and you can actually see other people's posts and reviews, and you have to dig a little bit, but you can see them.
So when somebody does a review,
yes,
does that pop up in like the news feed for certain?
It can. It can. I haven't looked at this specifically today. Social media changes so fast. I believe that you can actually, the person that's giving the review can decide, is everyone going to see this or not? And I do think that they can pick that, and then everybody will see the review. And how to deal with negative reviews, it's tricky, but you have to respond, right? Like, you have to write back. And if it's complete spam, like if it's someone that's just like bad-mouthing you like crazy, with Facebook, I believe it's still the case, is you can't actually just go and delete it. You actually have to, you can report it as spam, and then, you know, you can try and get it deleted, and I think you can. A lot of my clients, what we do is we try and take the conversation offline. You know, so we'll say, you know, sorry this happened, can we call you? And, you know, 75% of the time they can. Or they'll say, this person's been bugging me forever. You know, and it's just another way to do it. And I find that if you write back, people are more forgiving of that because they see that you're actually responding. The worst thing to do is just not to respond. And maybe just create like a template of how you do respond. And the same thing for like blog posts. You know, if someone writes back. With blogging, you do have the ability to monitor comments. Some law firms won't want to allow comments or that sort of thing. Not just reviews, but comments. I think you have to. Because the whole point of social media is like back and forth conversations.
If you are to respond to that post, are you responding like you're speaking with the person, or are you responding to your whole office?
I would say speaking to the person. And then, you know, if other people do see it, they will see. With social media in general, I find it's always good to talk with them. And then on a side note, they really will, people will look at it and they'll sort of apply that to their. Now, you should, law firms that kind of suck in general, they'll get a lot of negative comments. I don't work with law firms that do that. You'll notice that it doesn't happen now, but the law firms that generally kind of have a bad reputation or don't really do that well, you'll see lots. But my experience has been that most law firms have like a 4 to 5 star rating on Facebook and Google+, or Google reviews too, which is great because they show up. You know, like Google reviews show up on Google when people search people as well. No problem. Yes.
Question about the review thing. We normally have like 4.5 or 5.
Yes. Yes. I don't know exactly the answer to that, but they will go down. You can't ask people, please review.
Is this on Google? On Facebook. I believe this is Facebook trying to be measured, where they're trying to, instead of doing it chronologically, they're trying to show a variety of different opinions.
Yes.
Yeah,
yeah, and I find that their algorithm's crazy. I mean, it changes, like, all the time, and Facebook tends to act first and say sorry later. Like, they'll change the page layout, and you won't know. For the reviews, the more positive ones you get, it will kind of push it down a bit more. How many do you have? How many good reviews?
Well, there have been 11 reviews since.
Yes.
That negative review.
And they... Really?
Yeah, it's always.
You know what? I'd like to look into it, and I could talk to you and let you know. With Facebook, sometimes they hold more weight to the post that's being seen. You know, like the more people that are clicking it, the more people that are looking at it, they will kind of post it up. But I'm really interested to see how that happens, because like you mentioned, like...
Amazon does that, but they'll say...
Really?
Even if it has a lot of positive reviews, they'll highlight one that's like, this person is more skeptical.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, can you talk to her? I know. Yeah. It's the crazy ones that post, too.
My daughter is
Really? She did everything.
Let's
yeah.
Talk, just like you said.
Yeah.
And she said, come into her office, face to face. She went into the office, and then all she did was just badmouth everybody.
That's terrible.
I'm not kidding. We don't know what to do about this.
Yeah. You know, yeah.
Yeah. So I,
yeah.
I issued a response apologizing for the experience that they had and just indicating that I wish that I knew that you felt this way and we could have talked about it ahead of time. And that, you know, we would like to work it out with you if you ever want to, you know, feel free to contact. And I've had a number of people, that was 3 years ago, a number of people since then contacted me who reached me through the website, say, you know, we've read a lot of great reviews and this one bad one, but it sounded like they were crazy. You had a good response.
Yes. People will see that too. People will, I find that most people will look and they'll see she's a crazy woman. And maybe she's done this to multiple businesses too. And if, I mean, I don't know if everyone knows to do this, but I would search her name on Google too and see how many other, I mean, don't write this, but like search her name and see if there's lots of other posts too. But I think that the best thing you can do is write that response. And most people now are very forgiving of it because a lot of people write. Have you had anyone come to you and say they're not going to use you or anything through it?
This happened in June of this year.
Okay.
And it's the first time we've ever had.
And I hate that.
Like
yeah.
I did hire someone to review my response because it was so emotional.
Yeah.
Yeah, we did.
I hired someone to look at my response.
Yeah, all the
lawyers.
Really?
Response.
Yeah.
They're so afraid to post a response that's not going to be appropriate.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it happens. It happens. It doesn't happen too much. I would say to do the response is the best thing you can do, and I've been told to wrap it up. So if you guys have any questions at all, I'm going to be around. Please come up to me and ask or tweet, post, anything. And thank you guys very much for coming in. I really appreciate it.